Honor. May it please the Court. My name is Tom Weirwick, and I represent the appellants in this matter, Pacific Dawn LLC and Jesse Zawakwa Seafood Company. I'm fortunate to have with me today Bert Parker, Chris Peterson of Pacific Dawn LLC, and Bert's wife, Rochelle. We ask this Court reverse the District Court's denial of the plaintiff's summary judgment motion and the grant of the defendant's motion for summary judgment, and require that the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, as well as the Pacific Fishery Management Council, are required to take into account present participation and establish procedures that ensure the consideration of current harvest when it develops a fishery management plan.
They did take into account. They just didn't come out with the outcome after taking into account the, right? I mean, I guess my fundamental problem with
absolutely, Your Honor,
is that the statute does not require particular weight even to be given to that factor. It's just one of many that are thrown into the mix, and then the agency is entrusted with its good judgment to weigh them, and it came out with an outcome you don't like, and I guess I don't see a basis for reversing just because of that.
And I understand your point, and it gets to really the two issues I want to discuss today. The first is what could rationally be considered current or present, but the second, which is what your question points to, and so I'll cut right to that, is what can constitute the meaningful consideration that the Act requires? Because this case is in many ways unlike any I've seen before, where we have at the outset of the process, the agency says, we are not going to consider all of the data that is relevant to a statutory factor, and instead of establishing a procedure that would ensure the consideration of current harvests, instead, it is establishing a regulatory device that's going to prohibit the consideration of any harvesting activity after 2003.
Well, that's done numerous times, hasn't
it? I'm not aware of any case in which it's been done to such an extent that we reach a period that can no longer be considered to be rationally current or present.
Well, to such an extent, that may be the case, right? The 10-year or so delay between the adoption of the regulations and the control date cutoff, right, the 2003-2004 dates. But control dates are not unique to this case.
Control dates are not unique to this case. What this case really is about are what are the upper limitations of a control date's usefulness, particularly because it is such a severe tool.
So we upheld control dates, I guess, in alliance against IFQs.
Yes.
And there it was like 2 or 3 years. This one was 7, and I guess now with the appeal, perhaps even longer, I don't know. But the agency says, here's our reason for control dates. If we don't have a control date, we encourage bad behavior. I'm summarizing, thousands of pages of Federal Register.
Absolutely.
And so why isn't that a reasonable response that outweighs, in the agency's view, the benefits of taking into account more recent behavior, which may be changed, according to the agency, if they don't set a control date? If they don't set a control date, then I guess all hell breaks loose.
Potentially.
That's the agency's view.
And so I'd like to begin, and that's a very good question that has a complicated answer, and I'd like to begin with the wording of the control date itself. Because when the agency announced the control date, what it said was, we're announcing this control date to discourage increased fishing effort in the limited entry trawl fishery based on economic speculation. And so here's the concern. Congress requires that the agency take into account present participation. In 2007, when it reauthorized the Magazine Stevens Act, it added an additional requirement that it establish procedures that ensure the consideration of current harvests. And so the concern, obviously, is that if you're going to be considering what's happening in the fishery currently, that opens up an opportunity for people to try to go in and skew the data. But it's also a very severe tool for its implementation because it does exclude on the potential that some bad actors may attempt to skew the data. It excludes all of the data that's relevant to what is currently happening in the fishery.
I'm sorry, can you just go back that one step?
Yeah.
I don't quite follow. What's the potential for bad actors to skew the data when a control date has been announced? Close in time to the cutoff? I don't understand.
Well, so the potential, you have this potential that the reason we have control dates, what is it ultimately attempt to do? What a control date attempts to do is to keep the fishery from experiencing irregularities that would be based on the fact that the council is considering a change to the fishery. And so,
so why is that just a few bad actors? I mean, isn't it economically rational if you understand that a regulatory agency is going to base how much your allocation is based on present activity to go in and change the present activity? That's just rational economics for any participant in that sector. So why isn't that a fairly reasonable concern on the basis of the agency?
I'm not here to say that it's not a reasonable concern. But what I believe that Judge Kleinfeld was recognizing in Alliance is that because it excludes all of the data about what is occurring in the fishery, that there are rational limits on its application. Because in Alliance, it was clear that the agency had looked at the effect of what would happen if it looked at the more recent years. Also, in Alliance, the agency had proclaimed all of the benefits of the control date that are asserted in this action.
So you would have us say that, although reasonable is a control date, when there's this amount of time, then at some point, at some period of time, it becomes arbitrary and capricious. Is that what you would have us hold? And how would we determine at what point in time a fairly rational approach, as we said in Alliance against IFQs, becomes irrational? How do we discern that? It's a matter of law.
I think that the court in Alliance was already working its way toward answering this question when it said that the three-year period there, despite everything we've just discussed before, the consideration of the more recent data and the benefits of the control date, the court nonetheless said that in this case the three-year period was, quote, pushing the limits of reasonableness.
Did it explain, did it give the factors that should be considered to determine why that was pushing the limits of reasonableness?
It specifically suggested that those limits were based on the temporal period. It said the length of time.
I find that very helpful. Yeah.
So, and where we are here is really, is what is the rational limit of applying a control date? Because here we are at a period of 9 years now. We have allocation methodologies that were put into rule in 2013, where the last fishing and processing activity occurred in the first term of the Bush administration.
What was the reason for the lengthy period now in Alliance against IFQs? We said, the agency kept missing its deadlines. Now, so far as I know from reading the materials, there weren't missed deadlines here. So why was there a long period? Was it because of the complexity of this particular program? Was it because the regulated community had a lot to say? Or what was the reason?
So it's summarized in the record, and I'm not in a position here to suggest whether all of the meetings that were conducted were necessary, to what extent this length of time was required to do so. But I also point out that in 2003, the agency and the council certainly knew it had an obligation to consider present participation. And in 2003, it already had the utility of this court's decision in Alliance, which we can imagine that opinion being written differently, right? To merely uphold the period and say that control dates seem reasonable. What Judge Kleinfeld was getting across was that it did appear to be close.
They didn't explain why, so I don't find that helpful.
Okay.
So you would need to tell us, if we wrote an opinion, why we would say that 3 years is okay, but 10 years isn't, because, so what would we say?
Because a control date is so severe a tool by excluding all present realities of the fishery.
4 years okay?
Fortunately, I don't have to draw that line because we're at 9 years.
How do we determine that?
Right. Fortunately, we're at the position where we're at 9 years. I cannot say what would qualify, but I do know that the council and the agency were aware of this issue and did not try to develop any other tool that might alleviate the concerns that result from the statutory factors without taking away from their consideration essentially a statutory factor altogether.
Well, let me ask you this, because you're positing this as a 10-year gap, and I guess I'm not quite sure that that's right. It's not as though the agency completely blinded itself to the more recent data, right? Because it considered data all through 2010, was that good?
There were alternatives through 2010, yes.
And then this final rule is in 2013, so there's kind of a 3-year gap between that cutoff. And tell me if I'm wrong on this. I guess I understood the agency to say, look, we actually took a look at the data from that more recent period, and we tried to map out how that would play out in terms of the allocation. And actually, we see some negative consequences from relying on that more recent data that actually implicates some of the statutory factors that we are required to take into account, like, I think, increasing geographic and industry concentration, right? So the agency actually did look at the more recent data and found that, you know what, we don't really like the outcomes that it leads to, and that's another reason, in addition to wanting to protect the control date, that's another reason why we're going to stick with our guns. Why is that irrational?
Absolutely, Your Honor. So if we take the control date adherence out of the equation, let's look at those factors. I would love to address those factors. So the first is the supposed winners versus losers argument. And the argument here is that under the alternatives, that there would be a more recipients of quota who have a decrease in shares than an increase. Well, first of all, when the agency announced the program in 2010, one of the primary benefits, and this is at SER 18, was that it would shrink fleet size, with only the most efficient vessels remaining, leading to a decrease in the cost of harvesting. This is also the polar opposite of the reason it said it couldn't take into account more recent data in Alliance Against IFQs, where it said that the broader dispersal of quota shares was the problem. More importantly, as it relates to processors, every alternative, and this is at SER 239, creates more winners than losers in the processor sector. And so the question of whether that's a legitimate justification or if we've reached a point where we have a result that's more in search of justifications for it is certainly raised by that one. And on the geographic shift, the environmental assessment at SER 200 says the amount of quota that may be allocated is deemed to be relatively small as far as distribution, with an effect that is likely to be, quote, negligible. And the agency does not remember that the factors that we're looking at here are excessive shares, excessive distribution. The agency at SER 251 says the largest changes from status quo for any single port results in a difference of 1.3 and 1.7% a quota. And the court can see all the analysis on the geographic shift at SER 247 to 251. And so the question is whether this is a legitimate justification for excluding the last 9 years of the current reality of the fishery, or if these are justifications to uphold a result that no one can contest was originally based on no consideration of this data whatsoever. And we also have in the record legitimate explanations for the status of the fishery at the time. Remember that during this process, the agency put into effect in 2007 temporary rules that were based on participation in the sector, with participation being defined as landings. And in 2009, it actually excluded vessels from the fishery with Amendment 15. And it said, this is at ER 184, that the reasons for differences in the fishing market were not speculation, but instead increased whiting X vessel prices, increased prices for headed and gutted whiting. There's some discussion in the briefing about the movement from surimi to this headed and gutted product. Declining West Coast trawl opportunities due to overfishing species, rebuilding measures, and declining pollock quotas off of Alaska. So the agency has very good reasons to understand why the numbers are different. But the fact that they are different is not in itself a justification for excluding, giving effect to no effect whatsoever in any of this data. And so the question is, what rational connection do the supposed reasons have to the statutory factors, given that they are effectively excluding all of the data relevant to one of them? The question is, would that actually survive as a legitimate justification? I think there are serious concerns. And so I do want to save some time for rebuttal, but I also would just like to discuss PFSCAV blank, because I do believe that was actually a seminal moment in this case. So Judge Wofford, I understand you were on that case. Because it was during the reconsideration of this that case came out, and I think really emboldened the agency to believe that as long as they built a record, and certainly someone at the agency did a lot of work, there's no contesting that, if they built a record, that alone would be able to qualify as the meaningful consideration that the Act requires. But the problem is that in PFFCA, there's no doubt that the agency gave holistic, real, meaningful consideration to the issue there, which was, what is the role of communities in this program? It didn't say in 2003, well, no matter what happens, we're not going to look at what happens to communities, we're not going to give a role to communities. And then later, compile the data, but base its refusal to do so on the fact that it said at the beginning that it wasn't going to do it anyway. And so I think there is a serious difference between this case and PFFCA, where you have the counsel, and if you review the testimony from the counsel meetings, if you look at the record, the control date is the main issue here. And I think that at the end of the day, what this case is really about is what is the rational limit of a control date, something that is not mentioned in the Magnuson-Stevens Act, but it's instead a tool to try to implement Congress's will. If you're taking away from the equation a factor that Congress has required, can the control date be a rational exercise of agency authority? And so I'll save the rest of my time for rebuttal.
Thank you. The government, and then I understand you're splitting time with the other party, so please watch the clock.
I will, thank you. Good morning. May it please the court. I'm Maggie Smith here on behalf of the National Marine Fisheries Service, and I'll be reserving 7 minutes of my time for counsel for the intervenors. Before responding to the arguments that we've heard here today, I'd like to take a moment just to put what happened here into context. The Pacific groundfish fishery was declared a disaster in the year 2000 because of multiple overfished species and a vastly overcapitalized fishery. In short, there were simply too many vessels chasing too few fish for the fishery to be sustainable, either in an economic or a biological sense. So to meet this challenge, the Pacific Fishery Management Council began considering market-based management of the Pacific groundfish fishery, what it called trawl rationalization. And this included an IFQ program for the shore-based trawl fleet. This was an enormous undertaking. The groundfish fishery includes over 90 species of fish. It includes fishing off of three states, from Alaska to California. It has numerous sectors that require a number of different allocations and difficult decisions to allocate fishing privileges between different fishermen. And many have called it the most complex catch shares program ever undertaken in the United States, and that's a fair characterization. It is unique in its complexity. A fundamental cornerstone of this process was the announcement of the control date in 2003. This court has previously acknowledged in the Yakutat case and Alliance Against IFQs that without setting a control date, effort in a fishery will increase in anticipation of an initial allocation. And this is precisely what Judge Ikuda was discussing, that any rational actor, knowing that the allocation is going to be based on their fishing activity, will tend to increase their fishing activity. And we saw that also in the public testimony that was offered.
But your opponent is not contesting the rationality of using control dates as a regulatory tool, right? But I guess even you would concede that at some point, if you just get so far down the line that the present circumstances are just so different from, you know, some previously announced control date, that at some point you just can't continue to hold fast, right? And is that, do you agree that that's basically what we're called upon to decide here, is we've got to decide what's the outer limit of, you know, in terms of that gap?
I think that is the question that the plaintiffs are asking to answer here today. I guess I would have two responses to that. The first is that whether or not the length of control date was unreasonable depends entirely on the record and what was happening during the council process and what kind of program was under consideration. Here, we have a very strong record that there was forward momentum on this program throughout the 7 years that it was under consideration, that the 7 years was, in fact, justified due to the complexity of the program. There's no suggestion from the plaintiffs that the council or the agency was dragging its feet, that it took too long. And indeed, I think, again, the testimony in front of the council tended to show that the participants thought that the length of time was, in fact, justified and necessary to creating a proper program. I mean, in the second answer to your question, I think, is what did the agency look at when it made its final decision? Here, the record shows that the agency actually did look at present participation. I think this is contrary to what the plaintiffs are arguing here, that once the control date was set, the agency set up blinders and didn't look at anything else. That's not the case. That seems to be more what happened in the Alliance versus IFQ's case, but that's not what happened here. They did look at present participation. They looked at who owned permits and what the activity of those permit holders were, and they determined that the vast majority of quota was going to be going to active participants in the whiting fishery, and that, therefore, present participation was being considered and was, part of the decision. They also looked at allocating IFQ based on more recent history, and what they found was that they would be looking at relatively modest shifts in quota that would move. The movement would tend to concentrate the quota in certain hands and move it away from historic fishing communities in the south, both of which are outcomes that the agency is also required to take into consideration and to think about. So they would have a negative effect in that respect. And they also had to consider, what are the costs of crediting this more recent history? And they found that it would have significant costs with respect to the fairness and equity requirements that are required to be considered in setting initial allocations. There was a strong sense from the regulated community that the control date was a really important aspect of the program. It was something that they relied on in structuring their business decisions. People structured their decisions and fished those who own multiple permits, fished those permits in a way that, was not designed to develop fishing history post-2003. So the agency took all of that into account, too, and said the costs of crediting this more recent history are significant, and they're certainly not outweighed by what we see as a relatively modest shift in the movement of quota that is in and of itself sort of a mixed result, because you also have this tendency towards consolidation and movement away from historic fishing communities.
Would you agree that at some point just sheer passage of time could render a control date irrational?
I think that it would depend on the record and what was happening in the council process. I mean, here the council actually looked at programs around the country and said, when are control dates abandoned? When do they become stale? And they found that in other councils, what had happened was when control dates had been abandoned, it was because movement on the program had stopped. So you would see, an example where the participants wouldn't necessarily be on notice that the control date was valid anymore because, the council and the agency weren't making any sort of forward progress. This case, which it took 7 years from the beginning of consideration to implementation of Amendment 20, this fishery and this rationalization program, I think, is unusually complex. Here the time, I think, is very justified. And the record does show this relentless forward movement and a significant dedication of time and effort from all of the participants to get this done. So, I would say that the answer to that question is it's record-based. It depends on what's going on in the fishery. And I think that is exactly how we would ask the court to consider the statement in Alliance Against IFQs, because, in that case, the complexity of the program itself was not nearly as significant as the one under consideration here. In Alliance Against IFQs, we're talking about two species in one state in a particular, a sort of a subsection of the fishery that didn't have the same overfish species issues that the Pacific groundfish fishery faced. In addition, in that case, it appears that there actually was a lack of consideration of any post-control date information, which, again, is not the case in the record before you today. And then finally, it does appear that much of the court's discomfort with the three-year timeframe was based on the agency's failure to meet its statutory deadlines and the lag between the end of the council process and implementation of the final rule. And here, there's nothing comparable to that. The agency moved very quickly, it met all its deadlines, and implemented the program as quickly as it could have.
Can I ask you this? Do you agree with your opponent that if for some reason we
thought the part of the agency rationale that relied on protecting the integrity of the control team had become irrational given the passage of time. Do you agree that the remaining reasons given really just aren't of sufficient weight to sustain the agency decision here?
If they can,
like the control date rationale is really the dominant reason given. That's why I
asked. Right. I mean, the control date is one of, probably is the most important factor, but it goes to the fairness and equity question, which is, I think fairness and equity is mentioned 3 or 4 times under the considerations that need to be, you know, taken into account for the Magnuson-Stevens Act. So, it, you know, it does have a substantive statutory hook. And, you know, I think looking at the expectations of the industry, even if for some reason the control date itself wasn't a reasonable tool, I think you can somewhat separate that inquiry from whether or not the decision was ultimately fair and equitable. And I think, again, you know, looking to the testimony, seeing the overwhelming support for this allocation from the industry, even those that would have benefited more from the allocation that the plaintiffs are would like to see adopted, does speak really strongly to the fairness of the decision that was reached by the council and the agency. So, you know, the last thing that I wanted to just briefly touch on was the plaintiff's statements about the other considerations that the agency took into account, the winners versus losers argument, the geographic shift. You know, I would, they point out that the point of Amendment 20 was to shrink the fleet, and that's absolutely true. It's something that was an overriding consideration of the agency. But, you know, the statute also does say, you know, you need to strike a balance. You want some consolidation to make it an economically sustainable fishery, but the statute does, in fact, put limits on that and wants to avoid the consolidation of too many privileges in some hands. So, you know, that's a balancing act that the agency has to weigh. Those things are, you know, have to be both considered. And with respect to the geographic shift, you know, the plaintiffs point to the fact that you're looking at relatively small movements of quota, but I think that cuts both ways for them because, again, you're looking at relatively small movements of quota to those who participated, had larger present participation. And so, it's a relatively small movement of quota, but it has all of these attendant costs that we've discussed here today, and it was rational for the agency to consider that. You know, in closing, I would like to say just a few words about the process that was followed during the remand period. The record shows the critical importance of this issue to the council and the service and the fishery participants and other stakeholders. The council heard more than 7 hours of public testimony on this issue, and overwhelmingly, the fishery participants and other stakeholders supported the decision and agreed with the council and the service's weighing of the factors. There was broad consensus that this allocation was the most fair and equitable, and that the control date was an important and valuable tool that should be honored. And with that, if there are no further questions, I'll turn it over to the interveners. Thank you.
Good morning, Your Honors. My name is Tim Hobbs, and I represent the industry groups intervened in this case in support of the regulatory program at issue. I'll cut right to the control dates. The control dates were a critical component of this plan. They put the industry on notice that any harvesting or processing activities after that date may not count in the ultimate formula by which the fishing privileges were allocated. The purpose was to deter additional unwanted effort and capacity in the fishery because the fishery was overcapitalized in both the harvesting and processing sectors. That was what was making the fishery economically unsustainable. And so when the control dates were announced, the intervenor groups took those dates seriously and they committed substantial resources and took other actions in reliance on those control dates. For example, 18 permits changed hands after the control dates were announced. the average value of those permits was $315,000. Many of these were family fishing businesses. These were not insignificant amounts of money that people were committing in the expectation that this program would ultimately come to fruition.
Why did the transfers occur? What was the...
Sure. So the fishing permits had fishing history associated with them between the years of 1994 and 2003. And those were the years up to the control date that were going to be used in the allocation of the formula. And so the value of the permits reflected the amount of fishing history that those permits had in that critical time period. And so, for example, one participant went out and acquired three permits and eventually combined those permits together and took the fishing privileges from all three and put them onto one single boat. So now you had one boat that was doing the work of four, which is why that contributed to the drain of capacity out of the fishery. Similarly, go ahead, Judge Wofford.
And if the control date hadn't been imposed, then what would be the alternatives, rational economic move for that person to do?
Right. Well, without any control date, then the incentive becomes the opposite, right? It's to increase capacity, but, you know, get more boats, fish faster, fish harder. It's this race for the fish that made it so economically problematic. And another participant, for example, had two harvesting vessels, one of which needed substantial investments to overhaul it to make it operational in the fishery. Instead of doing that, they elected to retire that vessel and then take the fishing privileges that it received and put them on their remaining harvesting vessel. So again, we ended up with one boat instead of two. And the control dates never became stale because of these investments that were made and because the industry was constantly working through this process to get this program into place. Sometimes a control date is announced and then the council just stops working and perhaps it can become stale at that point. But that did not happen here. Everybody knew that it was working actively towards the implementation of this program. And the government rationally concluded that changing the allocation time period to use more later years would penalize those people who took action on the control dates in reliance on the control dates and who actually furthered the management objective of decapitalizing the fishery. And so ultimately the government concluded that it was fair and equitable not to change that line because of those reliance interests. If there's any questions, I'll reserve the balance of my time to Ms. Colbert.
Good morning, may it please the court. I'm Monica Goldberg for the Environmental Defense Fund. We're a national environmental nonprofit organization dedicated to conservation and management of sustainable fisheries, including the use of catch shares, like the program at issue here today. EDF is deeply involved in the development of the IFQ program throughout its lengthy development, and believe me, we would have preferred to have taken less time. In the hopes that aligning the incentives of the industry with conservation would result in benefits to the marine ecosystem, and it worked.
Impressive that all three of you are on the same side of the table.
And it's not that unusual when it comes to catcher cases because we were all aligned on PCFFA as well, because we do have environmental benefit and economic benefit resulting from these programs, which is why they work very well in many cases. So we do see that this program, is, in particular, has produced enormous benefits to the marine ecosystem off the west coast of these states, and we urge affirmance. And just briefly on the environmental impacts of the appellant's arguments, our sense is that their effort is to turn procedural requirements in the statute into a substantive requirement that the agency consider catch history right up until the point of instituting the catch share in setting allocations, and the problem is that that would invalidate the very notion of a control date. Obviously, as we've already discussed, the purpose of that is to signal to fishermen and others that they may not get credit for any additional fishing effort after the control date if an eventual catch share is set up. It basically stops the music and while the program's established. And if the agency can't credibly set that date, as Your Honor stated, all hell would break loose. The rational thing to do is to fish harder, increase capacity, raise further to the fish, which will exacerbate the very problems that the catch area is supposed to be designed to fix. And this isn't an academic question for us. We work in a number of fisheries around the country, including Gulf of Mexico reef fish, where just in recent months they established December 31st, 2015 as a control date for the headboat part of the recreational fishery there. So, it proceeds as we speak, and invalidating the ability to use a control date will have significant impact on the defendant's ability to sustainably manage fisheries in this country. We also have a disagreement with the appellants about the use of the characterization of the role of disruption here. They assert that the defendant's the allocation violates their statutory duty to consider disruption. Here, the disruption would have occurred by changing the control dates changing the allocation because people had acted in reliance on them, and the benefits of this program to the marine environment might have been sacrificed if the allocations had been changed and the program had been destabilized. So disruption actually would have been exacerbated and worsened by changing the allocations here. So just to conclude, after years of working on this really important program and mindful of the very significant benefits it has had to the marine ecosystem, EDF urges you all to affirm.
Thank you.
So as a preliminary matter, of course, the appellants do not contest the program overall and are not in this action certainly contesting whether or not it brings benefits to the fishery. What they're contesting is the allocation decisions. They're also not contesting control dates as a matter of principle. What they are contesting is whether a control date, which is a tool that the agency has developed to implement the will of Congress, can be used to such an extent that it effectively precludes the consideration of factors that Congress instructed the agency to consider. And we've heard a lot about the expectations of the agency.
I mean, I've heard you now for 16 minutes. What factor was precluded? What did they not consider?
If the agency
considered present, right? They considered the present use of the fishery. They just didn't go the direction that your clients wanted them to go.
That doesn't make it
a failure to consider, though.
Your Honor, I respectfully disagree that it's simply about whether or not it went my client's way. It's about whether the manner in which this data was considered and ultimately rejected on the basis that it wasn't going to be considered in the first place is in compliance with the requirement to consider data relevant to the current reality of the fishery. We've never had a control date applied and adhered to in a case like this to such an extent. And
the opportunity, right, because they had another notice and comment period, and you had the opportunity to explain all of this to the agency and get them to understand that having their mind made up with a control date was actually not going to be consistent with their statutory obligations. But whatever your arguments were, they weren't persuasive enough, and the agency gave their reasons for rejecting them. So what is it in the statute that would compel us to say that their reasons for rejecting those arguments was inadequate?
Because Congress doesn't say to imply a control date. It says to take into account present participation and to establish procedures that ensure the consideration of current harvests. And
there's nothing in the statute that precludes them from having a control date as long as they consider all the factors Congress told them to consider. And I think you can see that they did consider everything.
I can see
that. Just think that they had their mind made up while they were considering it.
Right, and also that hard local review requires them to draw a rational connection between the reasons for excluding this certainly remarkable amount of data. 9 years of reality in the fishery where even the agency admits that the fishery itself had experienced very significant differences. There has to be a rational connection between the reasons for excluding it and the factors themselves, and where control date itself is not a factor, but instead is a tool to implement the will of Congress. They cannot use it to simply take it out of the equation, and the hard part here because I don't know what limiting principle there is. Because if it's upheld here, you can have consideration of fishery management programs that could go 7 years, 10 years, and there's no way to know. When you look at the Madison-Stevens Act and it tells you that present participation will be taken into account, everyone can look to that and know that what I'm doing in the fishery, unless a control date has been announced that will have a rational ability to be current, that what I'm doing in the fishery will be taken into account in some way.
But the flip side is also true, that if we don't uphold this, then going forward, control dates is an important regulatory tool, as you've acknowledged, basically go out the window, because everyone will say, you remember what happened in that Pacific Dawn case? Who knows, maybe it won't stick. Let's get out there and try to increase our share as fast as we can, because who knows what will happen.
And I understand that point, Your Honor, but the rational limits are what the agency has before it begins looking into a program. And if it believes it's going to consider the program for such a period that it's taking it out of its duty.
At the outset, you acknowledge
that,
right?
The briefing actually says that it was anticipated that it would take so long.
9 years?
Five years, yeah. And so I see that I've outrun my time. We respectfully request that this court reverse. Thank you.